Because Judy's here, would it be okay with folks if we just move the approval of the minutes to after and we could start talking right away about the community housing
Oh,
proposal on the table?
stick your agenda. That's fine.
You sure? All
I
right.
may hang up.
The minutes shouldn't take long.
That's true. The minutes generally don't take long.
Sure.
So did people get a chance? I know I didn't give as much time as I normally do to review the minutes, but in my opinion, they're beautiful. Monty did such a good job.
Right,
There was,
right.
wait, I had one comment on the minutes. I'm just pulling them up so I can remember what it was.
Okay.
While Monty's doing that, I'll just say that I appreciate the fact that she captured my comment at the very end accurately. But I merely stated my belief that the planning board would not move forward on the community housing bylaw without the approval of the housing committee. I mean, we might, but it wouldn't, the optics wouldn't be great.
Your belief
I can't
is your
remember
belief.
What my comment was. It must not have been very important.
All right. Well, shall we? I'll entertain a motion to approve them.
Okay.
As is, assuming that they weren't right. Because again, I do think we talked about some things and this got it, I think, nailed down the salient points really well. So I'm very
I will
appreciative.
Move to approve the minutes as circulated.
Second.
Thank you. Everyone in favor?
Wait,
aye.
What date right now? February?
February 6th.
6th. Okay, aye.
All those opposed.
February 7th, actually.
I was just thinking it was wrong and realizing, oh, Monty said I had time to run and get my phone. And I was like, oh, darn it. I don't have a calendar in front of me.
Well,
thank you.
So obviously.
Okay, that was probably what I was going to say.
Was that probably your comment?
Yes, I'm sure it was.
Oh, great. I feel better. Okay, super.
Motion too soon.
Sorry, we'll sort of back amend. It's all good. As amended for the 7th, those minutes are approved. So the next thing we wanted to talk about tonight was this proposed community housing bylaw. And Judy came since this was generated from her initially. And I think she'll be in a great position to be able to share her thoughts. And there are quite a few revisions to this one from what we had looked at before, and I think addressing our concerns and probably other people's concerns around clarity and other issues. So I'll let you launch.
I'm happy to share, if you give me screen sharing,
of
I can share the most recent marked up with the yellow highlighting, Judy, and then you can comment on what motivated the various changes.
Great. Thanks, Brant. You're all set.
Okay.
Well, I understood that you were doing all the heavy lifting tonight, Brant.
Oh, okay.
Oh, that I was doing the heavy lifting. Well, I didn't even know you were coming. So, well,
I mean,
thank
I can't,
you.
But go ahead.
Well, so I'll just let everybody know here tonight that at the planning board's most recent meeting on February 28th, we reviewed this draft with, and we discussed the various highlighted portions. We agreed, we made no changes after discussion. We voted to move forward with a public hearing on this bylaw. Okay, so that's our next step procedurally. And we have scheduled said public hearing, or we've scheduled it. We're in the process of getting all the notices put out, but it'll be at our next normal planning board meeting date, Wednesday, the 27th of this month, 27th of March. We're going to hold the public hearing on a number of planning board bylaw proposals, including this one, and that public hearing on those various revisions, including this one, will begin at 5:15 p.m. on Wednesday, March 27th. All right.
Brent, so, could you make it a little bigger on the screen?
Just show the first page. The second page is irrelevant.
I certainly can do that. I think I can. What I'll do is I'll make it fit the whole screen, single page. We'll walk through it, and then okay. I can go back to double page. So procedurally, that's our next step, a public hearing. The planning board has not yet voted to approve it per se, but why this is relevant to this committee, which is not scheduled to have another meeting until early April, and thus after the planning board public hearing, is that typically we'll hold a public hearing, solicit input from whomever attends. I hope that all of us will use various channels to publicize this public hearing and alert people. I'll probably try to get something about this on the Facebook page. We missed the window for the most recent Whately scoop, which is a little sad. The next Whately scoop isn't until sometime in May, I think it is. But still, we want to try to get as many people to attend a public hearing as we possibly can who have an interest in this and other bylaw changes. And then once we do the public hearing portion, once we've heard all the input that there is to be heard, we'll close the public hearing. The planning board will discuss the matter and take some kind of action. That could be, we could vote on something. We might. I don't know that we will. Time is of the essence if we want to get things to annual town meeting. We could choose to continue the public hearing to another date if we decided we needed to. But tonight I would say let's assume that the planning board would, at its public hearing later this month, collect input, close the hearing, debate, and quite possibly vote on, say, whether we approve the bylaw in whatever form it is. We might amend it in that meeting based on public input. We might do any of a number of things, right? So, however, the potential exists for the planning board to be in a situation on March 27th of voting on this bylaw without some input from the housing committee if we don't take a position as the housing committee tonight, right? So if the housing committee doesn't want to say anything one way or the other about this bylaw, then, this is not your last opportunity, but if the planning board doesn't have any formal input from the housing committee at the end of this month when we have our public hearing on this bylaw, if we vote to approve it, which would mean, let me just say, if we vote to approve this after our public hearing, then we would prepare a report to the select board with our recommendations. And then it would be up to the select board to decide whether to put this bylaw on the warrant for annual town meeting. So there might be other opportunities for the housing committee to weigh in for or against after our public hearing, but it might be ideal to have a statement or some input of where the housing committee stands on this in time for our public hearing. And having said all of that, and in recognition of the fact that I'm doing this the first time as chair. Let me just check in with Judy to see if I've gotten anything right or wrong.
No, that's fine. It would I mean, the thing you've left off is whether we would go ahead with public hearing if the housing committee doesn't support tonight, but I assume we basically will. If you'd like me to talk to the changes on the document.
Yeah, I think that would be appropriate, ma'am.
Could I just ask a question, Judy, before you start, that came up for me about this? We talked about the timing of legal counsel review.
Yes, let me say, I speak to that. I have submitted all of these materials to town council for legal review, and I have asked town council to provide feedback in time for the public hearing at the end of March.
Town council typically tweaks things.
Yes.
I mean, you've seen it with, well, I don't think with CPA stuff, but they rarely make substantive changes. They tend to make editorial changes. You might use this word instead of that word. In my time on the planning board, I haven't seen a town council say, oh my God, you can't do this. But
so if we
even
want,
even if they do, I think what you might want to think about is that you either support or don't support the intent of this. I mean, what town council is going to be dealing with is the shape of the wording, not the intent of the document. So I think it's
potentially regulatory. I'm minorly concerned about affordable housing, like law overall, and what level it will play in when we are saying we're, but there, I can't speak to that at all.
Well, around, but I think town council can.
Right.
And if they say you can't say this, then we can amend it at the public hearing.
Can I ask you a question?
No.
Is that town council CONSEL or CONCIL?
SEL.
Thank you.
Fred had a comment.
Expensive lawyer.
So if we make editorial changes tonight, is town council going to consider them or not?
No.
Yeah.
This will be posted. If you would like editorial changes tonight, then we can take them to the public hearing and they would be adopted then.
Yep.
And town council will probably review the warrant and the documents there. I think we're making too much. I mean, this is, I've never known town council to do anything other than change a few innocuous words. I think this part of the process is important, but not important in the sense of getting the warrant right. I don't think it's very substantive in terms of the housing committee's opining on what they want this to, the scope of this, basically.
Speaking of little changes that the town council might suggest, I would like to suggest two changes before we even start. And that's in B and E, change occupant limit and occupant limits to occupancy. We are not limiting the occupants themselves. We are limiting the occupancy of the building.
I think that would be trivial. That would be
I easy. Think it's absolutely trivial, but I think it's proper grammar.
No, I meant trivial in the process, not in terms of what you're
saying. Yeah, no, I'm just for tonight's meeting.
I think that would be fine.
It should be so very.
Just hold on. Let me just intervene just to say, like, just to set focus on tonight. So we're not going to wordsmith this here and now in this committee tonight, because this bylaw in this wording is what's going to be posted and advertised. And this is the input to our public hearing. What we can do tonight, what the housing committee can do tonight, is come up with a list of recommended or requested revisions to the wording of this bylaw. And then those will be conveyed by somebody, I suppose I want to be careful. I'm chairing the planning board. I'd like to have somebody else from the housing committee attending, representing the housing committee at the public hearing on March 27th. But the housing committee should attend through a representative the planning board public hearing and convey during the input period what the housing committee's requests are. Then when the public hearing has been closed and the planning board is discussing what they intend to do, we will take all of that into account. You know, simple changes will undoubtedly implement then and there before we vote. But I just want us to understand tonight, maybe this is for Monty, as you're taking notes, capture a concise summary of any recommended changes to this bylaw from the housing committee. Okay.
Well, I know it's like we're making, want us to comment on it, but our comments are going to be separate from what's went to the town council, and they may or may not be presented in a public hearing. So why are we even commenting then? We're going in circles here about making comments.
Well, so to focus what we're trying to do tonight, I think we're trying to decide as a housing committee, so I take off my planning board hat, whether the housing committee is prepared tonight to vote on, what I came into this meeting thinking I would do is I would make a motion, I'll make a motion, we'll see if anyone seconds it, then we have discussion, and then we have a vote on the motion, all right? I was going to move that the housing committee endorse this bylaw recommend this bylaw for adoption at the public hearing. And so I would make that motion with the idea that then we would have a discussion, we might amend it, and then we have a vote that would
I'll
then
second
have...
the motion, Brent.
Okay. So that was, so Monty should have captured the motion as the motion is that the housing committee will and support this bylaw for approval by the planning board. I think that's sufficient.
And do we have to say at the public hearing, or it doesn't matter?
I think just leaving it as we endorse it for approval by the planning board.
Okay.
Right. The public hearing is just a hearing. It's not
right.
It's not a voting session.
Well, when we close the public hearing, the planning board will discuss and potentially vote.
Yes, but at that point, the public hearing is closed.
Yes, correct. Correct. Thank you. Yeah, well, exactly right.
And the idea is so that on the warrant, when town meeting comes around and each article is listed, we have the fine print underneath the article endorsed by or approved by the housing committee attached right. to this article.
That's right. That's right. And it may be that at the housing committee's meeting in April, we take another vote, because by that point, the public hearing will be closed. The outcome of whatever the planning board decided based on, like, what if people are like, tons of people show up and they say, no, no, no. I mean, maybe the planning board doesn't vote for this, right? So I would think that the housing committee would have another meeting and vote in April. And that would be the key vote into annual town meeting.
Right. And that would assume that what happens between town council and then anything else that comes up at the public hearing is actually set. I think I looked at the calendar earlier today. It's like early in April, April 3rd. That's 1 week after your meeting. That might be tricky. So,
town council is supposed to get back to us before the public hearing.
Right. So hopefully nothing additional comes up at the public hearing that delays.
And I think the procedure is that technically you can't approve anything more restrictive without holding a second public hearing. And there would be time for that if necessary. But I doubt that anything more restrictive is going to come up in the course of the public hearing. So you can make changes that are less restrictive.
Got it. Forward. Yep. That makes sense. Okay.
So the we're just going to have to go with the flow. Seconded. And so what we do now is we talk as a housing committee, how do we feel? What changes? Like, are we fine with this as it is? Judy will take us through what changes she's made that are highlighted in yellow. We'll try to understand it better. And then we could vote. Then we can end up voting on either we like it as is, we like it, but would like it better if certain changes were made, or we could come to the conclusion that we don't like it for some reason. So that's what we're doing now.
I'd like to request that we listen to Judy's explanation before we start commenting and making suggestions.
Yeah. Thank you, Monty.
As the person who made the motion, I'm yielding the floor to Judy for that purpose.
Okay, well, these are, I think, the changes since the draft you saw last. Some of them reflect changes that Megan Rhodes made. Some of them reflect changes due to my spending some time with the state zoning regulations. We had originally required that this document had required that there be permanent affordability requirements. Evidently, the subsidized housing inventory only requires long-term affordability. And that was Megan's insertion. Megan also wanted to take out the section, the reason I've highlighted it, is the statement recorded with the Registry of Deeds has been there all along. It was part of the permanent procedure. Evidently, that's not a requirement of this Commonwealth, but I left it in because I think it's an important element for enforcement. We spent some time with you last time on that. As long as it's recorded on the deed, there's no excuse for the owner not understanding and obeying. And I should point out that, as Catherine knows, even with the kind of grants that are made for historical preservation, the church has a requirement to maintain the windows for it in a condition acceptable to the Secretary of the Interior standards, which is what's required for preservation. Requirement of the funding agreement has to be recorded. That's a 20-year thing. The requirement for maintaining the silos that Quan Quan did had to be recorded. This is not a big deal, but I think it's important for us. Now, the occupancy limit thing It turns out that the state says, yes, indeed, you can relax bylaw considerations with a special permit. But if you relax unit numbers or occupant numbers, the instrument that relaxes that needs to show a cap. We already had a cap on the number of units. We did not have one on the occupancy limit. So I inserted one that it may not exceed 5 inhabitants. So that line E is really the only significant change since the last draft you saw. And it's a requirement of the state. I can't say that any great quantitative thought went into 5 inhabitants, but the place that this applies is with accessory apartments. And I have to admit that on the basis of not too much thought, it seemed to me that 5 inhabitants in even an expanded accessory apartment was probably plenty. So those are the changes.
Okay. And I'll just remind people who don't live and breathe zoning bylaws that what this new bylaw is doing is it's introducing a new principal use into the lexicon of our zoning bylaws. So we have a whole table in our zoning bylaws of allowable or known principal uses, ranging from things that we want, like single family residences, to things that we don't want, like commercial piggeries, all right? So number one, by adding this language to the bylaw, we would be defining a new principal use for a parcel of land in town. And then to go along with that new principal use, we add a row into our table of use regulations. And this, what I've highlighted here, is the other critical piece of this new bylaw. So there's the bylaw language that says what a community housing use is and entails and what's allowed as a community use, as a principal use for a parcel. And then this row that would be added, if this is approved by voters, this row specifies in which zoning districts community housing uses could be established, and further, what you might say control or oversight is associated with those uses. So here, trying to get everything on one page, we have 5 zones in Whately: AR1, AR2, commercial, commercial, industrial, and industrial. And what we're proposing is that in the commercial, industrial, and industrial districts, these community housing uses are not permitted, would not be conformant to zoning. However, in AR1, AR2, and AR3, community housing is allowed. However, a special permit from the ZBA is required in all cases. And site plan review by the planning board is required in all cases. So this speaks to Judy's point she's made multiple times that this bylaw combined with this row in our added to our table of use is where we are able to permit these kinds of new uses in town, but with oversight and control by both the ZBA and the planning board.
Could I make a couple of comments I think the bylaw makes sense for the housing committee?
Please do.
I don't know if you're aware, but current zoning only allows one duplex on a lot. So when you talk about two or three duplexes, perhaps with an affordable housing project, the housing committee would have to go for a 40B under current zoning. If this passes, no, you just have to go to a special permit. And the optics of the housing committee going for a 40B are not great. The same applies. There's a limit of 4 units per lot. So it would be impossible to put more than 4 units on the DeMaio lot without going for a 40B. So this quote, relaxation gives the housing committee a lot more flexibility in what they're doing. It also turns out that by a fluke, and it might not materialize into anything, that we might already have a candidate.
Yeah, I'm glad you're here to explain this instead of me trying to bring this up, Judy.
Okay.
I was like, am I really going to talk about this? It feels kind of gossipy, but...
Well, we don't have to be specific about the location in town.
Right, of course.
Well, I think we should... Well, okay. There is someone in town who is applying to the ZBA for a special permit for a duplex. And I was in conversation with Deborah Carney on another issue that the planning board, Deborah Carney is becoming chair of the ZBA, by the way, about another issue that the planning board was dealing with. And she said, Judy, are you aware of this? And I said, no. She said, well, the applicant called me this summer and said he'd already started to frame the building. And I told him to stop. And I drove by there this week or 2 days ago, and the whole exterior of the building is completed. So he has evidently constructed this without a building permit and without the special permit that's needed for a duplex. On top of that, when you look at the lot, he doesn't have frontage enough to build anything. I mean, this is a lot that does not qualify for even a single family house. Only has 160 feet and it's 175 feet of frontage. So he already has this building roofed and sided with windows in. I have no idea how much of the interior is done. But he's invested a heck of a lot of money in this building that he's never going to get an occupancy permit for. But the way the changes in the zoning bylaws work, once the public hearing for a zoning change is advertised, then that bylaw is effective, conditional on approval at town meeting, and also conditional on approval by the Attorney General. And the Attorney General has something like, I think, 90 days after town meeting to approve. So he's already got this building there, and he's not going to get an occupancy permit, except unless he puts an affordable unit in one of these affordable unit in one of his two units. Now, I'm sure he had no intention of doing that. I don't know whether he'll do it or not, but it's worth a heck of a lot more to him as an affordable unit than having the whole unit sit there without being able to be used for anything. So there's a good probability. So you might already have, I don't know, there's some probability of affordable unit here already. And just for what that's worth. I don't think it was clear, but it's the best I can do.
Judy, is this in front of the zoning board yet? Is it on
yes.
an agenda?
It's on their agenda for the 14th.
If it's on their agenda, then it's a public record and we can know what the address is.
It's the parcel in front of Seven River Road.
Okay.
So this is this is on the agenda for ZBA. I'm an altered member of ZBA. It's coming up next week. I don't know how
the public hearing. The ad for the public hearing shows up on the 12th. The ZBA meets on the 14th.
Right. Looking further, I'm not sure how ZBA is going to act on this. The building permit is for a storage building. He does not have a building permit for one or two or four unit development there. He submitted something to the building inspector. It has not been approved yet. So I don't know where he's going. What's being proposed
and constructed is... Two-story
storage building with
windows on both levels. It doesn't strike me as much of a storage building. Anyway, I don't know what probability to put on this, but he has applied for a special permit for a duplex.
Well, it's more than a duplex. This plan show more than that, and what's built there, what the public health is approved for septic and all is for more than a duplex. It's already taken action to do more than a duplex. So it'll be discussed at the ZBA meeting.
Well, it will. And Deborah has kept track of this. She knows she has the wording of this bylaw. She knows about the public hearing. She has inquired about rent for affordable units. We'll see what happens. I am not a prognosticator, but I think this was aimed at small projects anyway.
And as Judy said, to remind, there was a property owner in town who called me through Hannah a couple years ago, interested in building. She was interested in investing in her own property, but she wasn't interested in participating in any sort of 40B process, nor complying with fair housing, which is an advertising process related to sort of affordable housing. This might, depending on if the attorneys flag fair housing laws as something that need to be included around the subsidized housing inventory, which is a thing I don't really know about, but this might be a vehicle for this other property owner to also build something on her own property that she could use. She had said she'd love to do it, and her property was entirely, I don't even think it was suitable for one unit.
No,
I think
it was
a frontage issue. Did she have a frontage issue? Was it the same?
I don't remember. I think
she had some sort of an issue with this.
It wasn't a buildable lot, even for a single unit.
Right. But in this case, I think it would be able to be a buildable lot, and maybe she could put a duplex or two duplexes.
It was big enough to put a couple of units on.
It was like a 3-acre parcel, and maybe the frontage just wasn't enough or something. Yeah. So there might even be another... and so I've been really...
It would allow the housing committee to explore lots that aren't necessarily buildable under the current zoning.
Right. And it may allow that... Right. And it may allow the housing committee to actually, as I said in our last meeting, Judy, you weren't here to hear me like whining about the cost and the lack of available funding for small projects. If there are residents who are motivated to do something like this on their own parcels, sort of somewhat at their own expense, it may be a way for us to actually get affordable units, which I think is fantastic, especially right now where I'm feeling a little discouraged about what size of a project we may be able to get funding for, even if we do get sort of quote unquote custody of the Smikes. No, sorry, the LaSalle parcel. My brain's like swirling with some other things. No, see? Third time's a charm. The state road parcel what was the name of the restaurant? DeMaio.
DeMaio.
The DeMaio parcel, right? So that parcel, you know, I'm not clear there are any state sponsored funding sources, but this might give us some more flexibility to maybe solicit instead of the regular sort of nonprofit builders who professionally do this around the state, to find someone who's maybe a smaller builder with just an interest that might be interested in trying to build something. So it really will give us some flexibility. And as Judy has said about this before on Brandt in a prior meeting, it will also give us an equal or greater, depending on what way you look at it, amount of control over how things develop as time goes by with the site plan review and the special permit. So I'm feeling a lot better about it. I'm still unsure how much it will get used, but I'm more excited sort of now that we had this accidental potential use, and it sort of reminded me how it may inspire others to do something similar.
Well, you know, if it's used twice, you've got 100% increase in your units.
Right.
I mean, this,
our town has to aim low. Like, I hate to say it that way, and I don't mean it as a bad thing, but we're a small town anyway, and we only, you know, 2 or 3 units a year of affordable housing would be great for us, because you're right, we'd be rapidly multiplying the quantity that we have now of 2.
You know, zoning isn't going to solve the problems. So everything is incremental. Right.
Yeah, you're right. No, and we acknowledge that at the beginning of this.
This is a relatively easy way to make one baby step forward.
Yep.
Yeah, and so I guess that's the point, that as we think about this, let's not let the perfect be the enemy of the good here. There may be ways in which this could have or might be, you know, more like the bylaw of our dreams. But I think some of these numbers, like a 12 unit maximum, a occupancy limit of 5 inhabitants, is predicated on some strategy around getting something like this approved at annual town meeting without setting off a backlash. And I'm very concerned. I read too many articles nowadays. The hoo-ha in Milton around MBTA communities. You know, I read too much news about communities shooting down bylaw changes that are trying to promote more affordable housing. And I find that very nerve-wracking, and I hope Whately won't go that way. But we've asked town council, typical zoning bylaws require a 2/3 majority vote for approval at town meeting. A simple majority of voters at town meeting is not sufficient typically for zoning bylaw. There are some carve-outs, I'm not sure, in my reading of the Zoning Act, that we're gonna get lucky here. There's certain situations where state law, the Zoning Act, has been modified to allow certain kinds of zoning bylaw changes to be approved with only a simple majority vote. I suspect that's because the state has learned that there tends to be some opposition, and the state has a overriding interest in seeing some of these changes made. But we've asked about this bylaw, how much of it needs a 2/3 majority vote. We're just trying to understand the voting rules around passing this bylaw. My working assumption.
That's more than they need to worry about, Brent.
Yeah, but I'm bringing that up just again, because I think this is sort of why I want the housing committee, the more support that this bylaw has, that's formal, that's vocal, I've seen well-intended zoning bylaws go down or get tabled at public meeting, just be at town meeting, because just so many people just start asking questions. And then after a while, people are like, well, there's so many questions, we're just going to vote against this. So
maybe we should find out whether the committee supports it first.
Yeah.
That being said, does anyone have anything else? I know, I feel like two or three of us have been doing a lot of the talking, and I'd love for other people to bring up any questions or comments or observations in advance of us discussing if we are moving forward with a vote.
My only question is just a practical one with the 5 inhabitant limit. And that is, if you have a unit with 5, figure 2 people per bedroom, is the more appropriate number 5 or 6? If you're going to have, you by having 5, you're having 3 bedroom type units, whether bedrooms or a living room. I think if you figure 2 per sleeping area rather than 2 plus 1. That
Fred, there are other ways to come at this. There are public health rules about number of people who might occupy a sleeping area. Unfortunately, the bylaw we're trying to address talks limits occupancy in an accessory apartment to 2 inhabitants. And so we're just trying to correct that.
Okay, I mean, so, I'm not insisting. I'm just, this is just a purely practical.
No, it's a question, but, you know, I don't know. You could argue 4 or 6.
How do you define an inhabitant? What's an inhabitant? Is there a certain age limit?
A resident.
So, the other issue is that it's incredibly difficult to enforce. Let's say a family moves in with 5 people and has a baby. I mean,
we've had that discussion actually, Fred, and I think there is a certain sense that in an ideal world, which we're not living in, the existing bylaw for relating to accessory apartments would not use language like occupant limits, which it currently does, but rather use bedroom limits, because that's
there's a terminology that's used, health safety limits or something.
Yeah,
but unfortunately, we don't have time to research that.
That's right,
and
that's why I made that point about.
That's fine. As I said, it is not a philosophical issue.
It's a very valid point, and sometime we need to go through the bylaws and look at everything that needs fixing. But life is short.
Okay. The other comments I have, maybe editorial, maybe not, on F, designed to mitigate traffic issues. You're assuming to me, that reads there's a traffic issue there already, and you're trying to mitigate it with housing. I don't think mitigate is the proper word. It should be designed not to increase traffic issues or to facilitate improvements in traffic flow, something like that.
The wording is fine, because I think it's designed to essentially mitigate whatever traffic issues might arise, not to mitigate existing.
It doesn't say, I don't read it that way.
Well, that was
mitigate the traffic issues. That means there's
Fred Barron traffic has the issues intent, there. But I think we agreed, Fred Orlowski, that wordsmithing could be submitted for the public hearing.
Well, then why are we making comments tonight? We'll wait for the public hearing, I guess, so.
Well, you're making comments on the substance, not on the wording.
Well,
I think maybe we can just...
I mean,
whatever.
The point of F is you shouldn't make traffic worse. How it's phrased is an editorial comment, whether the comment itself is should be there, whether it needs to be there or not, is the kind of thing you would comment on here tonight.
The way I've been thinking about this, and the way I might encourage those of us tonight to think about this, is through the lens of harms and benefits rather than wordsmithing. Look at this bylaw and ask yourself, if this became part of Whately's zoning bylaws, do you feel like it would cause harm to Whately, however you define harm? Is it harmful making these kinds of changes to our zoning bylaws? An example that people would think would be very harmful to Whately, just to give you an example of what I might mean, is if we allowed lot sizes to be, you know, down from roughly minimum 1 acre to, you know, a quarter acre. Why are people going to say that would cause harm to Whately? Because then with the density goes up and everybody's in each other's backyard. So if this were a bylaw about reducing lot sizes from minimum 1 acre to minimum quarter acre, we could sit around and say, don't like that, that will cause harm to Whately. But if you look at what this is trying to do, and you see harm to Whately coming out of the changes that this would make in our zoning bylaws, that's a reason to say you would oppose it. If you don't see any harm, then the question is, do you see any benefits? We've talked about some benefits, some potential, how this could help provide a tool for the housing committee and others. Maybe there are other benefits, or you might say there are no benefits that you see, but there are no harms. And then you can decide whether you would endorse something that in your view was not harmful, but also not beneficial. So that's the way I'd suggest we think about it tonight. Harms versus benefits, then, and then use that to decide whether we're going to support it or not.
I have no further comments. I'm prepared to recommend it.
So am I.
I am as well. So do you think we should move to...
You call the question.
Thank you. That.
So now we're voting on the motion. There were no amendments to the motion.
Oh, you know what, Monty? Could you read it for us just to refresh my memory of the language?
Maybe you could stop sharing.
Sorry, what, Judy?
I was going to suggest Brant stop sharing.
Oh, yes.
Sorry, Bonnie.
Brant moved that the Housing Committee support this bylaw for approval by the Planning Board.
Yeah, I'm ready to support that. Should we take a vote?
Yep.
Everyone in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Very good.
Can we...
So then the Planning Board did have a question for the Housing Committee if this were the outcome. And Judy, we were hoping that the Housing Committee might be able to either prepare something informational for the public hearing. Could you remind me what that was?
Well, one thing that's important is that people understand what affordable housing is. And that was a big point in the housing production plan, that there needed to be an education effort to point out that affordable housing isn't just Section 8, it's really workplace housing and housing for a goodly number of residents of Whately. And I think for the public hearing, it's important to have some documentation of that. And as a practical thing, it would be much better coming from the housing committee than from the planning board. But I mean, it could work the other way around. We could draft something and you could endorse it.
Yeah, but I'll just say that I, on a side gig, I guess, as it were, I've been working with Megan Rhodes on getting prepped for the master plan, and I had helped a little bit with getting that survey out. And now that it's set, she's scheduled some meetings, one of which is going to have a focus on housing, which is the week before this meeting. And I had committed to reviewing some slides with her for a similar purpose, so that anyone that chooses to participate in that, so I can, it will be cutting it close a little bit, and but I just don't.
Well, I think what we need is a talking point paper.
Yeah.
Bullet point. I mean, like something one short, short and sweet. And I did circulate that information about Whately salaries, town salaries.
Yep. Yeah, I think Megan and I were thinking about using them, although I don't know what Megan was thinking. I was thinking about using it a little differently, but
for this we need a, you know, half a page talking point thing.
Yeah.
Saying what the affordable limits are and then pointing out what that means for people in Whately, either both in terms of average or medium incomes for everybody. But then I think as you and I have talked about, knowing what town employees
are. Who that might, yes.
So I sent you the medians, the highs and lows, the percentiles. I mean, I can give you the whole distribution if it would help, but you know, median for a full-time Whately salary person is something like $60,000. I mean, it's in that range. The average is less than. Even Brian Domina didn't make over $90,000, which is pretty close to the.
Yeah, a family of four, which maybe he is the area median income is 98.
He has two incomes, but. But yeah.
Oh yeah, so right. But if they didn't, points. That's the point though, Judy, right? If he didn't and he wanted, that's the, they wanted a, that sort of
what bullet point. And look,
yeah.
Of our town people, 90% of them would qualify, of our full-time employees, you know, things like that. Just slam it in your face. Nothing subtle here. This is propaganda.
The other piece is really if you show, I don't know if you looked at the table of rents when I in that as well, but you know, the maximum allowable rents for affordable are again, I've been out of the rental market for a long time and I understand that things are crazy, but the rent numbers to me still feel pretty high. It's not like we're saying, oh, a two-bedroom apartment is only $700. It's like $1,500. Like, there's still high rents that you charge.
So anything we can do to help, but it would be great if you could come up with something before the 27th.
Yeah, I'll come up with something before the 27th. I can't guarantee how many days or weeks in front of it will be. So there might be a little going back and forth or edits that week.
And seriously, if there's anything I can do to help.
I'll after I think about it and relook at that email. Yeah, if I want more detail, I'll let you know. But I can do that.
Thank you.
Yep.
I would be happy to proofread it or take a
look at it. Oh, thank you. I appreciate that.
Yeah. Brant, this meeting is not for wordsmithing. What do you see as the procedure for tweaking the wording?
So I think that my recommendation would be an email from somebody, Catherine, to the planning board that just summarizes the requested wording changes.
Why don't
the only problem with that is we're not discussing it here, so the board The housing committee will not have agreed upon wording changes.
I think individuals could send suggestions.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that's fine. It doesn't have to be. The wordsmithing can be not as the committee, but rather individuals.
Okay.
Happy to. Public comments are more than welcome.
Yeah, yeah. And really sort of a heads up, like tell all your friends to go to the public hearing. Even the ones you think are going to, anyone who you think is against this and would speak out against it, you know, we need to know what the points of view are. And I think it, when it, it, assuming this reaches annual town meeting, I've learned, I think we've all learned from past experience, at least on the planning board side, that the old strategy of just hoping that everyone would vote to approve without any framing by the planning board doesn't often work. So we, probably both the planning board and the housing committee, should plan on having some presentation or some remarks to present at annual town meeting before a vote on this bylaw.
My vote is PowerPoint.
And if I can suggest presentation for town meeting, keep it short because this will be at the end of the meeting.
Yeah.
Yes. Oh,
right. Sorry.
We'll do that. As hard
it
as
it won't be
is.
5.5 hours though, like sure. Amherst, right?
Right. People are getting ready to leave at that point.
You're right.
We can do that.
Yeah, and that might be a little bit of a concerted effort around. I know, especially if I'm going to end up being the spokesperson, I might be asking a lot of questions to get a lot of prep for me doing the public speaking, because I get flustered by antagonizing questions.
The planning board will.
Yeah.
We'll present. We'll be happy to brief you in advance. We
couldn't rehearse. Couldn't we do a joint presentation? You know, this is
the
planning board and the
And I like the idea of it feeling together as a cooperative anyway, because I think
that would be more powerful too.
Yeah.
It would,
people watching.
And PowerPoint's fine if it rains and the meeting goes inside.
We're still doing outside, aren't we?
We can have a handout. We can have a handout.
Okay.
Yep.
You know,
thanks
that
for reminding me, Fred.
By Norman Rockwell, that guy was not talking to PowerPoint. He was just standing and speaking at a town meeting.
Yes, but
he was waving.
How much of his argument would have been if he'd had a PowerPoint?
Yeah, that's right.
You have more items on the agenda. We've taken.
Yeah, we'll just we just talked about one of them. There really wasn't a lot because last time we did spend a good amount of time talking about this, and I didn't want to feel like we had to cut discussion off at the expense of anything else. So,
can I ask a question, kind of related to the community housing thing? What could come up at public meeting, and maybe not, but what we're proposing is the possibility of, with 4 units per lot, with up to 5 people in each unit, that's a 20 inhabitants at one lot. There is probably something like that, or what? How are we controlling the farmers in town that have on-site housing for their workers? Is there limits to the number they can have? Is there bylaws control how many units or where they can be?
Fred, the occupancy limit only applies to accessory apartments. That's the only place in the bylaws where that shows up.
Don't
worry about it in any other context. This is only applies to new construction.
Well, we don't have elsewhere in our bylaws anything about occupancy limits for any of our uses. You know, we don't, for any of our residential uses, as far as I know.
And I think all of the farmers Workers' housing predates zoning. It's all grandfathered.
Well, I don't know.
I think there's absolutely no bearing on that.
Okay, but you could have
this
a new one.
This applies to new construction, Fred. It doesn't. It doesn't have any relationship to anything existing.
Yeah. So if a farmer is like, "Oh my God, you're going to change my existing structures with this," it's like, no. It only goes into. It only affects.
Only affect things that are built after this right. is approved.
Okay. So a farmer could propose a building like this to house his workers. That's an option. Yeah. That would be allowed.
It would be, as long as 25% of them had long-term affordability requirements registered with the Registry of Deeds.
And they could probably end up with 100% affordable and actually get funding for that through USDA, which I think has migrant housing program, or they used to. Anyway, but that's also not super, I mean, I don't know, maybe it is relevant. Maybe there are farmers that would want to.
Farming is exempt from zoning. It may not apply at all.
Housing related to farming, though? I mean, I have no idea.
This is zoning. Farming, most farming except for marijuana is essentially exempt from a town zoning. So it's irrelevant, Fred.
Well,
you know that. You know farming, you know agriculture is exempt.
Right, but still, what is being proposed on River Road? I know just a proposal. There's a possibility there could be 20 people living in that one structure. They're working on farming. There's farming on both sides of the road, so you could have. I guess that's
the 5 person limit has no applicability to that at all.
Yeah. So
you could skip there.
So there's no limit.
We don't know anything about that. Think about this in the abstract, and don't apply the occupancy limit for accessory apartments to somebody's special permit for a duplex. That doesn't make any sense.
I think that what I'm hearing for that case on River Road is that the lot is already not buildable, right? That right now there's some essentially illegal building that has taken place on this lot. Is that a fair statement? It's illegal because there was no building permit. It's not authorized per zoning. But if this bylaw were in effect, then the zoning requirements that this project currently violates could be waived by the Zoning Board of Appeals if it were deemed to be a worthwhile project.
And the ZBA could then condition the number of occupants if they wanted to.
Okay.
So this becomes a tool. I mean, I don't know that we want to use this tool coercively this way, right? But it's kind of an opportunity, you might say, that's maybe fallen into our laps.
And maybe it will incentivize someone who's got a lot that they've thought about doing something like this with. I don't know.
The point is, Fred, that if the guy wanted to go and file for 40B, he could do it without any conditions at all.
Yeah.
Okay. So it's many of you know the property on River Road, a lot of farm properties change hands in the last year or two. And these new people that have occupied the parcels of land, if they want to add housing for their workers, they're working on a farm, they could do that, and this bylaw would not apply?
If they are farmers. I mean, you're the ZBA person. If they're farmers, agriculture is exempt.
All right. But Judy, do you really think that agriculture, as defined in the Zoning Act, includes all the residential structures to house the workers as well? I mean, I don't know. I haven't read.
I don't know, but if
I don't know either, but I would think it would, that the farm would.
I would think it would.
Yeah, I don't know what.
It's critical to making the farm work. I know, Sandra.
Yeah.
Most of these people can't work without their seasonal workers.
Right. Yeah, I have no idea whether it is or it isn't.
But we're outside the scope of this.
Well, that could come up at the public hearing. How are you going to deal with this if farmers want to do this?
I think I would say that farming is exempt if they've already got it. It doesn't apply. If they want to do it going forward, and they can make a case that it's an important, essential part of their farming, they can do it. I know that if a farm wants to put a solar facility on, and more than, I think it's 75%, at least 75% of the production of the solar facility goes to the farm, the town's solar bylaws don't apply.
Okay.
I mean, farming is a big exemption.
I'm skimming, I know we're off topic. I'm skimming the Section 3 of the Zoning Act regarding agriculture.
You can't possibly skim that. It's impenetrable, even with
yeah.
You could spend hours reading it and not understand it. It is unskimmable, Grant.
Okay. Well,
don't try.
Okay. Well, I'm not sure I'm seeing anything about housing. That's all.
Maybe to Fred's point, that's something that we ask the zoning committee to help us figure out before town meeting.
The only things that are exempt are environmental and health, to the best of my knowledge.
Catherine made a really good point that we should just find out how to answer people's questions if they come up during town meeting so that we can address that.
Yeah.
We've got several months.
Yeah, we have several months. That's right. So I don't think we need to rush, but I do think that's probably a worthy question. Is it okay if I just move to do my little plug for Megan and the survey and the, so I think today or tomorrow is the last day of the survey that people were all sent for the town. The survey had questions about different topics that would apply to the master plan, and it was an attempt to solicit a decent amount of information. I know that over 100 surveys were received, which is better than we've had, better luck than we've had with other surveys we've done, so I guess that's pretty good. The committee is trying to advertise, although it's a very tiny square on the Whately webpage I looked this morning, some meetings that will be some in person and some digital, or Zoom rather, publicizing discussion of the survey results and sort of starting a town conversation about getting ready to do the master plan work. And so Megan wanted to do one of those meetings, especially about housing. And so out of the days they scheduled the meetings, I already only had no night meetings on one of those nights. So that's March 21st. So I will be at Town Hall for that meeting, and it will have a housing focus. If people have an interest, just check in with me, maybe via email, or just show up. I am going to try to help her get some. She wanted to do some poster boards and have people able to leave notes about different sort of talking points around housing in Whately. So I haven't really participated in this type of a pre-effort for a strategic planning process. So we'll see. But I mean, I think it's great.
Does it have a name, this meeting?
It, It's funny. I'm glad that you asked that. I'm going to relook at the website because I did not think that the wording represented what I feel like I've been working on. Oh no, maybe it was changed a little. This one says town visioning underway, attend an open house. Town so
visioning, open house.
Town visioning. Sorry.
I actually remember doing this for the last master plan. Yes.
Okay. Yeah, I haven't participated in that this type of a pre-process before. So Fred Barron, I know you had sort of said it feels premature, and Megan sort of said, and our funding is over at the end of March, and so if you want us to do these sessions, this is when we're doing them. And I'm like, okay. So that's it. That's the info for you specifically about.
Can you make sure that session get recorded? I know, I'm just looking at my calendar. I cannot make it that on the 20th.
Okay. Yeah, I will. Let me write it down. But I will. I have to follow up with her this week anyway. I'll probably ask that they record all of them, actually, because that you guys may want to go back to them as select board members, is depending on what people do say and don't say or what comes up. Okay. That was actually all I had. Does anyone else have any new business or other items to attend to? Yay.
Move
motion
to adjourn.
Second.
Yay. Moved and seconded. I'm in favor. Order. Would anyone like to join me? Great.
All right.
Thanks again, everyone, for coming.